All right, shall we? Okay. So as I mentioned, since we have the contest today, we will have a very short lecture and we will be covering tail recursion, which is a special kind of recursion. So in order to be able to make a comparison, let's remember how we implemented factorial function yesterday. Let's say we are going to be only dealing with small numbers and integer will be enough to keep the result. And in our recursive version of factorial function, like we get n as an input, and we define our base case as n equals 1, or actually 0 would work too, let's say. If n is 0, then we turn 1. Otherwise, we turn n times recursive factorial n minus 1. So, if you remember, once we deal with this factorial, recursive factorial function, let's say we also have the main here. And we are printing out 5 factorials to the screen. Alright, so once we get the function call, what was happening is this is our call stack. Like, since we start from the main, we have the state of the main as the first element in our call stack. And then once we make a call for factorial r with input 5, so we have a new object in our call stack, like r5. And this one, since n is not equal to 0, is going to call fact r4. And then it's going to call fact r3, fact r2, fact r1, and fact r0. And after it reaches to 0, it's going to get into this if statement and then return 1. So that 1 is going to be given to fake R1. And then fake R1 is going to multiply it with 1. And then 1 is going to be given to fake R2. And fake R2 is going to multiply it with 2. And 2 is given to fake R3. And then it's going to be multiplied with 3 and come as 6 for fake R4. And finally, we have 24 for fake R5. And then we return 120 to main. As you see, in this function, we needed our subproblem solution. And after we receive that, we manipulate the result. Like, we actually apply more operation on top of what we get. And that's how we generate the result for the problem we have in hand. Therefore, once we go to R4 from R5, we have to keep track of R5. Otherwise, if we don't keep the state of fake R5, then we are gonna lose multiplying fake R4's result with 5. So in order to be able to perform this operation, we need to keep track of this state, and that's why we have all these function calls as separate states in our call stack. So, in normal recursion, as you see, as we go deeper and deeper, we are going to have more and more elements in our call stack. So, tail recursion is a special type of recursion in which, instead of making manipulations or some more operations on the results of the recursive call, we are returning the result directly. So imagine we are writing our factorial function with tail recursion style. We are going to add a new parameter after, but let's go top down. Let's say like our best case is going to be the same. Return 1. Somehow we are able to write our function in a way that we can just make a call to our subproblem solver function and then just get the result out of it. Like right now this code is not complete. Obviously if we run it, we are going to return 1, right? We didn't make the modification to make it run for calculating factorial correctly. But first, let's look at the structure of this function. Once we make the fact tr call with input 5, it's going to come to this statement and then it's going to say, okay, actually return the result for fact r 4. Like, let's simulate our call stack for the call of factor 2. Call stack for fact tr. Okay, not fact r2, it's fact tr. Or like fact tr, yes, there is. Yes. Okay, so we have the main, obviously, since we continue execution. And we make the call. So since this function is called, we are going to place factTR5 in our call stack. So at this point, once we come to execution of factTR5, we check whether n is equal to 5. N is equal to 0. That's not the case. And we come to this statement. And here in this statement, there is something different than the initial version. Instead of making modifications on return subproblem's result, we actually return it directly. Like here, it is multiplied with n. That's why we had to keep track of the state. However, here, do we really have to keep track of the state of factTR5? Like basically, we are giving the result of factTR4 directly. Is there a point of keeping something? Whatever we get, we are going to give it directly. So there is no changes happening. So that's why there is no point in keeping this guy in our call stack once the call for factTR4 happens. So instead of going like this, in case of tail recursion, the compiler realizes that actually there is no modification happening on the subproblem's solution. So it gets rid of factTR5 and then directly places factTR4 on top of main. And once factTR4 starts execution, 4 is not equal to 0, it's gonna call factTR3, and compiler again realizes that the return value is gonna be just the subproblem result is going to be just returned. There is no modification happening on top of that. So it's going to overwrite factTR3 on top of factTR4. And then 3 is going to call 2. It's going to be the same thing. And then 2 is going to call 1. It's going to be the same thing. And then 1 is going to call 0 finally. So we are going to reach to our base case. And then factTR0 returns 1. And then that one is directly given to me. Because imagine if we fill the call stack like this. What was going to happen? 0 was going to give 1 to 1. 1 was going to give 1 to 2. 2 was going to give 1 to 3. So like the same value was going to be given up until me. Right? So instead of keeping everything in call stack, the compiler smartly overwrites the values and says, we don't have to go through all this thing. So the final result can directly be given to main. There is no need to keep the in-between states. The reason is we don't get any benefit from that. Like, we directly return the result. So here we see why the tail recursion is not filling up many elements into the call stack. Now let's see how we can make use of this. Like, obviously our factorial function is not working right now, right? So the way we can modify is we can actually pass more information with the help of some other parameters. So instead of having only one parameter n, we can basically create a field for to keep track of the result. And initially, we can call it with 1. So here, once we get to our base case, we can just return the result that we accumulated so far. And if that's not the case, we can decrease n by 1 and multiply the result we get by n. So let's see what's going to happen right now. We call our function with 5n1. So factr 5 1. Which function this is going to call? Factr, tell me the parameters. 4 and 5. Yes. And this is going to call factr 3, 20, yes. And this is going to call factr 2, 60. And this is going to call factr 1, 120. And this is going to call factr 0, 120. And what this guy is going to return? 120. It just returns the result, right? So this guy is going to be given to me. And is it going to work as expected? Yes. Is this a recursive code? Yes. Is this a recursive code? Yes. And once you run these two codes, you are going to see an enormous performance difference. Because here we are making use of tail recursion property, which is going to help our compiler to optimize the call stack so that we will only have one element on top of main. We are going to be overriding the state because we don't need anything else rather than the result of the subproblem solution. But in the first version, we need the subproblem solution to create our solution. But on top of that, we are applying some modifications. So that's why our state has to be kept in the call stack to produce the correct result. However, in the case of tail recursion, that is not the case. We solely depend on the result of our subproblem solution. So we design our code in a way that we make recursion call, but we do not modify the result. So this is as if writing the code iteratively, right? In the iterative version, we weren't putting any weight on the call stack. So if you can reduce your solution into tail recursion version, again, you don't have to worry about the call stack anymore. And you get the benefit of recursion. Like, if it is easier to write the code in the recursive way, still you can get the benefit of recursion without getting the cost of call stack. So, any questions about recursion so far? Yes?
Would it be different if we declared the result variable outside of the function as a global
variable?
Yeah.
I mean, you could have produced the same result, yeah. But thanks for asking this question, because I want to make a warning about global variables. Like, in the concept of interviews, you can think as if you're not allowed to use global variables. The reason is, Whenever you use global variables, it's going to be a negative point for you. Because you are supposed to solve the problem you are given in the span of the function signature that they provide you, you know? So any solution you come up with that uses global variables can be modified to a solution which doesn't depend on global variables. So yes, it is possible you can get the same results by not having additional parameter but a global variable, but it is not desirable. So moving forward, I highly recommend, unless like it's making things very clearer, I suggest not using global variable because it's going to be negative. But let's say you are in a position where you couldn't come up with a clean solution that doesn't use global variables. At this point, it's like a solution with global variables is better than not having a solution. Okay? So, in the order, first we try to use, not use global variables and come up with a solution. And after a while, you try then, unfortunately you couldn't come up with one. At that point, then you can fall back to a solution with global variable. Okay? Any other questions? All right. Thank you very much.